possible that in some point in your life you've been called a slacker. Now, that may not be the case with everyone, but true or not, could you think of anyone better to call you a slacker than my next guest? He is best known for his cocky, hard-nosed characters that he plays with ball-headed flair. He chewed out Tom Cruise and Anthony Edwards in Top Gun.
He was out to get Matthew Broderick in War Games.
And he was single-handedly trying to take on the forces of Skeletor in his own backyard in Masters of the Universe. Today, he joins us as the high school principal with the best slacker radar in town. That would be Mr. Strickland in the Back to the Future movies, a trilogy in which the original film just recently celebrated its 25th anniversary. No pun intended here, but it's a trilogy that is truly timeless. It's a pleasure to welcome the one and only James Tolkien to the Critics Show. James, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Well, it's my pleasure, and obviously, you're not a slacker, I see that.
Well, it's good to know that. I just wanted to make sure that I gave you an introduction that was worthy of all the great work you've done, sir.
Well, thank you very much. I do appreciate that.
You're more than welcome. You know, so few people really get a chance to be part of an iconic movie, much less an iconic trilogy. And on top of it all, you have a memorable character with memorable lines that everybody knows. What does that mean to you?
Well, it's interesting to me because when I first did that movie, it was a very small movie, and it was not really a very large part. I played many bigger parts, and I'm kind of surprised at the attention it's gotten, the way people remember the character, remember my dialogue, and it's made me kind of infamous in a certain way. And that's what I remember most about that particular movie.
Well, how many times have you had to say the word slacker in the last 25 years?
Oh, countless times. You know, I do autograph shows, and people come by, and they're calling me slacker.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, it's interesting.
That's funny. Well, you know, for a guy that was cast to play simply a high school principal, I think it's safe to say that you are much more than that. I mean, you make your presence known very early in the first movie. We see you firing a shotgun at gang members in the second film. And then you play your own distant family member while riding around as a lawman in the third film. This had to be a blast of a character to play.
It really was a blast, and thanks to Robert Zemeckis and Bob Gale, who wrote the part and wanted me in it. At the time when they called me, I was doing a play on Broadway. I was doing David Mamet's play, Glengarry Glen Ross.
Ah, okay.
Which won the Pulitzer Prize. But they had seen me in a movie called Prince of the City. Okay. And that's why they called me. That's what they thought of me. And I said, you know, as an actor, I said, I'm never going to Hollywood until they send for me. They were in Hollywood, so they called, and I went out to Hollywood, and I did that movie, and then I did Top Gun. And I stayed out there doing movies and TV for, 8 or 10 years. And it was just interesting. It just worked out beautifully.
Wow, that's great. Well, yes. What was the scene that you saw in the script that you couldn't wait to do and had the most fun playing out in the trilogy?
I didn't have that feeling about one particular scene. I just had a feeling about that character and the story itself. I thought it was absolutely brilliant. And I don't know if you know, but the original Marty McFly was not played by Michael J. Fox.
Right, it was Eric Stoltz.
Eric Stoltz. And we had been filming for 7 weeks, I believe, when they decided Eric Stoltz, who was a very good actor,
yes,
was not quite right, and they shut down production. And they waited for Michael J. Fox to show up from his television series, Family Ties.
Right.
And they shut down production and started all over again. And that was such a brave move, but it was the key to success, I think.
And I was going to ask you if you had been part of that production that they had already shot that had to be done over.
Absolutely. And not only did they reshoot, they rewrote. And of course, nobody had any idea that this movie was going to be such a success. Spielberg, he was producing it, and he was more interested in a movie called Goonies at the time.
Uh-huh.
So it caught everybody by surprise that this movie became the great success that it was.
Well, that's always good when you get surprised like that. You put all that effort into a movie, especially one where you have to stop and start over.
It's a very good surprise, that because, you know, in our business, failure is the norm.
Right.
So when you have a big success, it's wonderful.
Well, I love it in the first movie how right off the bat you catch Marty and Jennifer trying to sneak into class late and you give him a really good intimidating talking to. And I mean, you get right up in his face. You're about a half inch from Michael's nose and you tell him that no McFly ever amounted to anything in the history of Hill Valley.
You got it right.
You know?
That's right.
And I'm wondering how many takes that took, because sometimes if you're that close and you're pulling off a scene, you can't help but kind of break a laugh every once in a while. Were you guys able to knock that scene out without breaking?
Oh, I think we did it about 3 takes, really.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, sure. And, of course, I like we're doing it. I like capturing the scene in the first take or the second take, usually. I'm spoiled by having worked with Sidney Lumet a few times.
Mm, yes.
And with Sidney Lumet, when he works, he gets it the first or second take and he moves on. That's it.
Wow.
But he sets it up perfectly. He makes it perfectly feasible for you to get it done. This thing of 30, 40 takes, which is also comes up,
yep.
That's really boring.
Yeah, I bet so.
Yeah, but it's expending your emotional energy.
Yeah, and you've got to have all that energy for the rest of the day.
Exactly.
Well, I read that all along you were the guy they wanted to play Mr. Strickland. So did you just get the call, get the script, make the decision, and off you
exactly.
go?
Exactly. I understand that I was the only actor they ever asked to do that part. They never saw anybody else, and I was very, very honored about that.
Yeah, well, they knew what they were doing because we all know how great you were at it. So
oh, well,
they knew
thank
what they
you very
were doing.
Much. And, you know, again, I say again, it was not really a very big part, but it made an impression.
It did. Well, and can you talk a little bit about some of the other memorable characters that you got to interact with? I mean, obviously with the work of Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd and Tom Wilson.
Oh, well, you just named them all. I mean, mostly with Michael J. Fox, who was such a pleasure to work with. And, of course, Christopher Lloyd is a New York actor. We did a production in New York of Macbeth at Lincoln Center. So I know him from New York. So it was just like old whole week working with him. And, of course, a lot of the young people, the young girls and so on, I got to meet them in L.A., and they were new to me. But the biggest thing, it was Zemeckis, Robert Zemeckis,
yes.
The director. He was an absolutely brilliant fellow. That was really the exciting part of working Back to the Future.
Well, you know, you definitely have, no matter whether it's Back to the Future or Top Gun or any of the roles you've played, you have a very memorable and recognizable persona. And I've talked to character actors
who have a variety of experiences of people coming up to them on the street
and swear they know them from somewhere but don't always remember the name. Have you had a few of those experiences yourself?
Often that's the case, and that's fine with me. They remember the face. They often hear me speaking, and then the voice. They
yes.
remember me from my voice. And they don't always know my name, but they remember me from the auditory part or the visual.
Well, you pursued acting in the 1960s after serving in the Navy. What was it that drew you to acting?
Well, you know, I didn't want to be working in some factory somewhere.
Yeah.
In the Midwest or anywhere else. And when I got out of the Navy, I hadn't seen my father in 7 years when I got out of the Navy, and he was now in Iowa in the cow business.
Mm-hmm.
So I joined him, and I drove a cattle truck for a year. We used to haul cows down to Fort Worth and Waxahachie, Texas. Oh, yeah, and all kinds of places. I knew all those Texas cattlemen. And my father dealt in a purebred Holsteins. And it was something very interesting. And then I didn't know what to do with myself after being in the Navy. So I went back to college. I started off at Cole College in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. There I got interested in acting. I was majoring in art and minoring in music, and there I got interested in acting. So then I transferred to the University of Iowa, which had a big theater department. And
yep.
when I went to Iowa, I found out that if you're serious about acting, you got to go to New York and study the method.
Mm-hmm.
So after 6 years of college, I got on a Greyhound bus at Iowa City. I went and I had $75 in my pocket, and I went to New York to be an actor. And I get off the bus, and I'm scared to death. I said, "What is this?" You know. And if I knew what I was getting into, I'm not sure I would have had the courage to do it. But I hung in, and I studied with Stella Adler, and then I started working, and then I studied with Lee Strasberg, and I kept on working and working, and I hung in. And endurance counts for a lot.
Sure. Well, and the military will train you for that, too. And I just mentioned that you served in the Navy, so I think it's only appropriate to thank you for your service as well.
Oh, well, that, of course. But, you know, I had good training before that. In high school, I was a high school football star at Amphitheater High in Tucson, Arizona.
Yeah.
And I got a scholarship to play football at Eastern Arizona. And in high school, I averaged 9 yards per try my senior year. And, you know, I got a real good coach, and that was a good training for me, you know, the discipline and the competitiveness of sports. and it stayed with me my whole life.
That's great. Well, again, thank you for your service as well. And did your time in the Navy help make it a little easier to get into character for Top Gun?
Oh, absolutely. And when we were filming at Miramar, I said, okay, I want to talk to some of the guys, the squadron commanders. I was playing a squadron commander
right.
in Top Gun. And I said, I want to talk to some of these guys. And I said, you know, when these guys, when they screw up, how do you talk to them? And this guy said, well, just here's what recently happened. These guys screwed up. And I said, listen, son, your ego is writing checks. Your body can't cash. You're going to fly yourself right into a box. That's what the guy said to me. So I wrote it down, and I went to the director, and I said, can I say this in the movie? And they said, you can say the first part, but you can't say the second
part. Yeah.
So that was my special contribution to Top Gun.
That's great. Oh, that's great that you picked up that line from a commander.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
That's awesome.
And people remember that, you know?
Oh, yeah, that's one of the most memorable lines from very early in the movie.
Absolutely.
That's great. And once again, you're in somebody's face.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you played a man to be reckoned with in many of these films, Top Gun, War Games, and even the cop in Masters of the Universe. Where did you get the knack to play such good, tough, hard-nosed, no-nonsense type characters in the
films? You know, when I studied with Stella Adler, she said, you know, in the theater, you can play all kinds of different parts, which I did. I played good, bad, comedy. She said, but for movies or television, you have to pick a character and harden it for the business. And that was what I did in terms of that kind of a hard-nosed character. And it worked for me.
It sure did.
Yeah.
You know, War Games is another classic high school movie that you were in. So here's a question. As you watch these movies now, War Games and Back to the Future, what's the weirdest thing to you? Seeing Michael J. Fox listening to music on a portable cassette deck and using a big video recorder, or watching Matthew Broderick use floppy disk in a modem?
Well, it's all strange to me, really. It's all beyond me. You know, I don't even have a computer.
Well, you know, that may not be a bad thing.
It may not be.
That's right. As I said, you've played many memorable roles. They're real, they're powerful, and most of all, they're really fun to watch. There's no denying that, and there's no denying that in real life you're a great guy and a really, really a lot of fun to talk to. And James, I really appreciate you taking time to talk with us today on The Critic Show.
It was my pleasure, Scott. Thank you very much.
You bet. All the best, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.